Hello there. Perhaps you noticed that Miss Coffee Bean is fascinated by lots and lots of data. Too fascinated, if you ask me. With the scaling law paper in Vision Transformers, and now with How to Train Your VIT, we are seeing impressive performance of big transformer models on lots and lots of data. With the release of How to Train Your VIT, more than 50,000 models, yes, 50,000, have been released by the Google Brain team. Which is great, because these models do not have to be trained again and the whole community can start using them. Miss Coffee Bean, did you sound the foundation models alarm? Oh, come on, who invited the term foundation models into this video? Miss Coffee Bean, we need to talk. About the question whether VIT counts as a foundation model, about the term foundation model itself, and about some interesting points we saw in the foundation model paper, like the question of understanding and generalization power of models under distribution shift. Miss Coffee Bean, are you ready for this? Should we sound the rant warning alarm? Feel free to skip through the video chapters when it gets too much. While reading the abstract of this new, who are we kidding? It's machine learning, so this is already old. I was saying that I was reading the abstract of How to Train Your VIT, which explains to us how vision transformers can be adapted to many downstream tasks. Oh, so this must be one of these foundation models, right? You know, this paper, rather a book, published by everyone at Stanford, where they rename pre-trained models into foundation models. But there's no mention of VIT or DIT, just a reference among many others to the paper about emerging properties in vision transformers. That's it. So why didn't they mention VIT? Honestly, no idea. Let's check the definition of foundation models to see for ourselves. A foundation model is any model that is trained on broad data at scale and can be adapted, fine-tuned, to a wide range of downstream tasks. VIT is trained on more than 300 million images. But is this broad enough? How broad is broad data at scale? Is something like ImageNet with 1.2 million images large scale? I mean, it seems like 2009 it was, but nowadays ImageNet counts as academic-sized dataset, and it is put into contrast with the hundreds of millions of images VIT was trained on. So is ImageNet now big or small? What scale does scale have? Well, let's suppose that 300 million images for VIT, a scale that not many have, is large enough. So condition of broad data at scale for VIT, check. Second condition, can be adapted to a wide range of downstream tasks. But again, how should we know from this definition that this enumeration is wide enough? What about now? How wide is wide? Well, how is this definition of any help in making terminology more accurate? You see, me and Miss Coffee Bean have a love-hate relationship with the term. Miss Coffee Bean, the YouTuber, loves it. I am the PhD student and I am mad at this as a small bystander to this PR stunt that seems to have worked quite well. Even if there are enough people in AI who criticize this move, there are people already happily starting to use this term of foundation models. Small PhD student rant here, but was it really a necessity that now every time one uses this term that fits everywhere and just replaces some older non-attributed terms, all these researchers have to receive a whole citation. Okay, but forget about this. Let's look specifically at the section where they explain why they chose the name they did. They say that this term, foundation models, will fill a void. Void I was not really aware of. We cite, existing terms capture the technical dimension. Because the grandeur of a paradigm shift is not visible. So their idea is, let's replace exact technical terms through a vague term, which is literary and metaphoric in its interpretations. Because on one side, we have the confused researcher about when to use or not to use the term foundation models. for the VAT example or ResNet. But on the other side, the uninformed broad public and possibly supporters of this new Center for Research on Foundation Models should suddenly get it that it is about models laying a foundation, but that a foundation does not build an entire house. This is deep. Well, I'm making Miss Coffee Bean angrier and angrier because she does not agree with me. You know, Miss Coffee Bean, who was created by a PR move herself, actually loves this. It's nice. It's more drama, more PR, more catchy terms for grant applications and paper titles. So do not forget to add this one to your list. Even more, from the perspective of someone who is not involved in research on these models, or from the perspective of someone who likes to educate the broader public about AI, what is really, really great about this paper is that it is an extensive place to learn all about these big models for anyone not closely familiar with them. It's like a manual. So she wishes you happy reading of a document where researchers had no space limit. Now, not really to spare you the reading, but more to give you some spoilers, here are Miss Coffee Bean's favorite takes from this book, or paper of 200 pages, whatever. It was really scary to read the section about incentives, where they say that, we cite, just as the pharmaceutical industry has little incentive to devote significant resources to the research and development of malaria treatments, because poor people cannot afford medications, the tech industry has little incentive to devote significant resources to technologies designed for improving the condition of poor and marginalized people. So, in contrast, universities are much, much better. But I don't know if things are so black and white. When Miss Coffee Bean sees the broad spread aversion of academics for actually doing science communication, and that there are companies that do better than described here, we're not that sure. Then Miss Coffee Bean and me both like the section on understanding, where it is all about the questions that are going on lately after seeing how good these models become. But do they understand? Does GPT-3 understand? We even had a video previously about the restricted question of whether a text-only system could ever understand, asked by Bender and Koller, and a follow-up on what more is required to get to understanding, based on a paper by Bisk and collaborators. The view in the Foundation Models paper is a little broader, with snapshots taken from different philosophical sides. And you know, when it gets philosophical, opinions tend to diverge. The paper tells us that there is the metaphysical question of what understanding really means, and then people's answers diverge. But supposedly we get an answer there on which we all agree, then we need to go further into the epistemological question, which is a fancy word for saying that we are unsure about whether we would ever be able to exhaustively test and analyze and dissect the model to know whether it has understanding. This means that even if a model would have understanding, we would not be able to say whether it does so, because we might not have the right means or even the right measure for detecting understanding. The authors highlight that it's the same with intelligence, with the Turing test that has been passed many times already, but we still don't call these systems intelligent because we keep moving the goalpost. We even like to leave the question open of whether understanding even matters in these models. Right now, we do not know, and people keep disagreeing, exactly like me and Miss Coffee Bean. My opinion, me as a researcher, is that understanding is a crucial component for these models. Only then we can trust them, be comfortable with them, and rely on them when they do difficult things like driving our cars or caring for us. And then there's Miss Coffee Bean, the incarnation of pragmatism. She thinks that we do not need models to understand for us to comfortably interact with them. We interact with things that we do not understand daily. When browsing a website, most people do not know about IP addresses and DNS servers or any other technicalities of the internet, but they use and trust it nonetheless. Miss Coffee Bean thinks that in the future, at the moment when these models will get close to perfect, it will all become a risk assessment. Supposedly, we know from lots of data statistics that a self-driving car crashed 100 times in the last 20 years and otherwise was driving perfectly throughout the whole world. But we know that there were thousands of human drivers that crashed due to alcohol consumption or whatever in the last 20 years. Do we really need to know that a self-driving car understands to trust it more and to use it? What do you think about this? Let us know. The comment section is for you to crash. Otherwise, in the paper, it was nice to see more emphasis put on the data creation process and the push to create a data hub for the whole community, because these models rarely, and by that we actually mean never, get any better than the data they are trained on. Then it is even more surprising to see how the point on distribution shift was set up. So this is a point we really thought we need to discuss. It's not about the message itself, with which we think we agree, but about how the message is presented. We cite, existing work shows that pre-training on unlabeled data is an effective general purpose way to improve accuracy on OOD, which is out of domain, test distributions. This and almost every other machine learning talk Ms. Coffee Bean heard makes it sound like increasing the amount of training data increases the out-of-domain performance. Don't get us wrong, we completely agree that scaling up the data increases performance. But we do not really agree on this strong emphasis on OOD. So OOD means that we have types of data that the models has not yet seen. This is of course in contrast with in-distribution, which contains types of data that models have already seen. I mean, look at the example here. In distribution is satellite data of the whole world, since the model was pre-trained on that. Then how is satellite data of Malawi out of distribution, since Malawi is part of the world? We are OOD skeptics in a sense. We have not yet seen these models perform well out of their comfort zone, which is OOD. What we have seen is how expanding the amounts of training data, the in-domain distribution was expanded a lot too. We just make the training data so huge that most of the testing you do is actually still in training distribution. In other words, nothing will be ever out of training distribution if the whole world was seen during training. And combine this with our incapability of really imagining huge data amounts, and we are ready to think that we have created something more powerful than it actually is. Why can GPT-3 write HTML code and perfect this in few short learning? Because it had HTML code during the pre-training stage already. But why do we talk about data samples like they were out of distribution when they are mostly an interpolated version of a sparsely sampled in distribution? The authors give the example of Clip performing well on ImageNet Sketch. But of course, it was trained on 400 million images from the internet, where enough of them were containing sketches. To us, it seems like foundation models are not really a solution to the generalization problem, since one just completely resolves the need for generalization by letting the model interpolate or even specialize during fine-tuning, but not generalize. We do not negate the advantages of scaling up data. It works very well to increase the data so much that everything becomes in distribution. But we just advocate for more honesty about where the performance gains of foundation models actually come from. If you're looking for real alternatives and real out-of-domain generalization, where your model can really handle new data that is substantially different from what it has seen before, look in other places. Someone in this community proposed Jeff Hawkins' HTML model. Check it out. Otherwise, we really enjoyed and appreciated the section on alignment, where the authors say that one challenge is the misalignment between the foundation model's training objective and the desired behavior. This really speaks from our heart. And if you want our take on this in relation to Clip, watch our video where we highlight how alignment has already started to be a problem, when Clip's normal behavior, following its training objective, was blamed to have been the victim of an adversarial attack. Well, wow, this was the video. Congrats for making it until the end. But what do you think about foundation models? Let us know your perspective in the comments to help settle my divergence with Miss Coffee Bean. Do not forget to like and subscribe.